everybody. How are you? Yeah, it's the Ramble. You know it's the Ramble. And it's here until midnight tonight. And what we're going to do today is do something we tried to do last night and have a little audio going here with our good old friend, Larry Bubbles Brown. The thing didn't run last night, or ran last night, but it didn't run well. So, you know, we're going to just let it run now.
So, Bubs, like today, we couldn't, you had to do the interview earlier because you had a doctor's appointment.
This is a week of doctor's appointment. Yes, I'm hitting everybody. My doctor, the dermatologist, the endocrinologist, I'm seeing one more, too. Trying to get everything done this week.
Do you remember when the only thing you had was a dentist and fuck anything else?
You know? I had the dentist. Yeah, that was it. Yeah, so
Do you like?
Body falls apart. So.
Do you like going to doctor's appointments?
No, not I hate it. But.
See, I've gotten to a point where I actually believe that I may not go in for my yearly checkup, mainly because at my age, one day I'm going to die anyway. And why should I be terrorized in the meantime? Because every year I go to the doctor, and it's at least some element of terror. This year was that my PSA had gone up by about a point, so I made an appointment with my urologist, who yesterday said to me, "You're fine, you know. Come back and see me in 6 months. Let's take another blood draw, see if it goes up. If it does, I'll do a little rectal, sonogram." He said, "I don't think you're in any bad shape with anything here."
You know? Oh, they just came out with that yesterday. They said if you're over 65, they said pretty much don't even take the PSA test. That that cancer grows so slowly, they're pretty much saying ignore it.
Well, what they said was here was what they said, and it's funny that this report should have come out yesterday, because I'm such a hypochondriac that when I was worried about my prostate, I looked up PSA tests continually. On the web, so much so that now, you know, those little things that are targeted to what your needs are in the ads, you know, that come up on pages like on Facebook, are all prostate stuff right now. Anyway, that same theory was put out by Sloan Kettering in 2012. Saw the same exact thing. They were warning against it, saying that the trouble with the PSA test is some doctors will see it. They will say, "Oh, your PSA jumped. We have to do a biopsy." Biopsies can cause bleeding. They can cause pain. And worse than that, they can cause infection. All right? People do die from PSA biopsies. Not a lot, but they do. And so that's one thing they do. The other thing they do is sometimes they go, "Oh, well, let's just rip the prostate out and have done with it," you know, because of the PSA numbers. And when in fact it may be a very slow growing, which most of them are. And most guys, you included, will probably, if you one day die at 90 and they do an autopsy, will find you had prostate cancer, but that's not what killed you.
No.
You know, it's a very slow growing. I mean, some are aggressive. Those are the ones you got to worry about. But those will become apparent in a lot of other ways. So they're saying, why do this? That you cause undue pressure on people, you know, and that you shouldn't do it. I read somewhere in something that was written, God, in 2007 or something, that you shouldn't even give a PSA to anybody over the age of 75.
Yeah, I think that's what they're saying now.
Yeah. So, anyway.
Same with thyroid cancer. A third of the population has thyroid cancer, and it's like prostate. It grows so slowly, and they found out when they do autopsies on people, they have thyroid cancer, but they've died of something else.
Well, you had thyroid cancer.
Yeah, right? I had mine removed, and now I wish I hadn't. So.
Why?
Because I could have lived with it, and. Then you have when you get removed, you have to take a pill, and it takes forever to get that thing balanced, and it kind of fucks you up. So
yeah. Well, listen. In the old days, the last 30, 40, 50 years, there were things we did for certain illnesses, which now are looked upon as just plain stupid. You know, I mean, you really, you know, like appendicitis. you really could solve that problem with antibiotics.
Really? Wow, I didn't know that.
Well, I mean, appendicitis means your appendix are infected. What kills infection? Antibiotics. But no, they just always took the appendix out. Now, it happens to be kind of a vestigial organ, an organ we don't use anymore. So, like my penis is a vestigial organ.
No longer you.
And so you can take it out, but, you know, you're cutting into somebody. You know, a lot of things they used to do, they don't do anymore. A lot of things where they would immediately jump on it, they have a wait and see attitude. And so it changed that way. But I went through literally, you know me, I'm a hypochondriac. I was years ago. It only gets worse, okay? It doesn't get better. And I worried about this whole thing that, I'm not going to live past the doctor's appointment. You know, he's going to tell me, it looks like you got cancer, or we've got to go do a biopsy or whatever. I go to the doctor. He's the nicest guy in the world. He said, oh, biopsies? He says, I'm so conservative, I try to never do a biopsy. He said that they're terrible. He said, if I can suss it out in other ways, I'll do it that way before I ever do a biopsy. So I feel confident.
Horrible.
So I like this guy, you know. And the reason they become the reason they have you come back in 6 months is not because they think you're dying. They have you come back in 6 months because doctors today make so little money that they need to have you come back in 6 months. What was the yearly checkup has now become the come back and see me in 6 months and we'll test it again, you know, because he needs that money. They have to do a volume business. Because the insurance companies aren't paying off well. Medicare is, they pay off fast, but they still, you don't get paid off well there. So these guys, doctors who once, you know, you thought a guy was a doctor, he's got himself a yacht and all of that, and that was probably true. It's no longer true. I saw what they get paid. You know, you get your thing from the insurance companies, and you see what the insurance company paid or what Medicare paid, okay? And the guy will charge $200 for the visit, okay? He's lucky if he gets $35.
Really?
Yeah. Jeez. And it's not just Medicare. You say, oh, Medicare. I had a doctor who said I'd rather have do Medicare than some of these insurance companies because Medicare at least pays me off within 3 weeks. Insurance companies take months, and you have to haggle with them. So I do feel sorry for doctors. So if he wants me to come back in 6 months, happy to do it. You want me to come back every month just to have a chat and you can charge money for it? Do it. You know, you're a good doctor. You're a nice doctor. You should do okay out of me. But that's why they keep bringing you back. Like,
yeah, a good guy because those PSA tests they can jump up and jump down and last thing you want is my friend of mine got a biopsy. He said it was incredibly painful and a lot of bleeding.
Yeah. Yeah, and they just go, we're just going to do a biopsy on you. Fuck you.
You know? You got a good doc.
Do you know what my guy does? He's really different. And I was amazed when I first saw this. He has a sonogram machine in his office. And he looks at your entire renal system with the sonogram. He says, oh, look, your kidney. See, you got a cyst on your kidney. No big deal. The worst that's going to happen is it will pop and the liquid will be absorbed by the body. He said, but, you know, you could have it the rest of your life. It's not affecting your kidneys. All right? And I had a cyst on both kidneys. A little like baseball on either side of my kidney. I thought I was pregnant. Anyway, he uses the sonogram. And I said, what about the digital, the rectal exam? He says, if I don't see anything suspicious, he says, the rectal exam, what I've also read too, is that the rectal exam, which they've always called the gold standard, right? Mm-hmm. It only can find what's going on in the front of the prostate, not in the back of it where most cancers are.
Really?
Yeah. So the finger, you know, he says, it's, you know, it's, he says, if we need to, he says, if your PSA goes up a little bit and I want to check the prostate, I'll stick a sonogram probe up your butt. He said, and it'll be no more uncomfortable than if I were to use my finger, and I will get a picture of your whole prostate. You know, he said, much more valuable. So, I like this guy. I really like this guy. I've been to. And I told him this. He said, well, usually urologists are pretty nice guys. I said, I have been to a couple of urologists that were just horror shows. You know, I had a guy who did two cystoscopies on me. That's where they stick a thing up your penis to look at your
bladder. Oh, that's horrible.
Have you had that?
When I had my first kidney stone, they did that to look in the bladder. And I said, ooh.
Why did they do that for a kidney stone?
I know. Well, this is like... God, it's early 70s. I don't know why they... I think they wanted to make sure that I had passed it from the kidney to the bladder, so they wanted to look in the bladder, and then after they did that, I couldn't pee, and I had to get a catheter, and
I got an infection. On one of them, I got an infection. You know, I suddenly started a fever and everything. I called the doctor, and said, oh, I'll call out to get you some antibiotics. I go, well, thank you very much for you.
And
what are you cleaning your cystoscope? Sewer water? I mean, you know. And you walk into this room. Oh, folks, I know this isn't entertaining, and I like to entertain, but it's therapeutic. I go in for my first one, and they've got the cystoscope there. It's a big, huge, long thing, okay? Like a garden hose, okay? It's not that they're going to use the whole thing for it, but for some reason it looks that way. And so that I wouldn't be upset by it, they have it covered, right, with a tarp, okay? So I go in there and I lie down, and then they take the tarp off. And here is what looks like a coiled up snake. And he says, okay, here we go. You know, and they go into your penis and put in something to dull the thing. Okay. So they then start going in and say, I'm turning a corner. This may pinch a little. You know what that means. Ouch. And then he's in there, and he says, it's only going to take like 2 minutes. And he's looking around. He's got a little camera or something. He's looking at a screen, and he's looking. And I'm saying to him, you know something, unless you find money in there, you better get out pretty fast. This is, you know. The second time I did it, it was easy because I knew what I was in for. This guy just terrorized me this way. One time he took because I've always had blood in my urine, just a trace, okay? But blood in my urine. And I've had it for 15 years. So my doctor said, if you've had it for 15 years, that's just you, you know? That's just something in your system that's producing the blood. It could be a kidney, it could be anywhere in the renal system. So he said, nothing to worry about. He said, if it was the first time, we'd be concerned. But this guy, every time he saw blood, he would send it out for a test. And one of the tests came back and says, you have abnormal cells.
Yeah.
And so he had to do another cystoscopy. And then I read somewhere that abnormal cells show up in older people. It's just you get old and your cells go wacko, you know. But it doesn't mean anything. You're not dying of it. So, you know, this is all the things that... So I'm thinking of never going to a doctor again. I'm thinking of never...
Yeah, just another procedure he can charge you for.
Well, not that. It's just that every time I go, every year I go, I get... he takes blood. All he really does, my regular physician, is he takes blood, sends it out. The report is faxed back to him. And then he mails it to me with little notations like, you're in trouble here, you know, whatever. It's not like... I'm getting this really expert, close following of my body. because he doesn't even know who the fuck I am when I go in once a year. I have to remind him that I have blood in my urine. You know, I have to remind him of all these things, you know. I walked in this year 55 pounds lighter than I was last year when I went in there. And I had to tell him I lost weight because he didn't know me from Adam. And by the way, my wife also goes to the same doctor, has been going to him for years, and she thinks he knows who she is. But they don't. They act like they do because they look at your chart and they go, oh, so how is your wife? You know? But I keep thinking that why should I go in once a year, terrorize myself? You know, I'm going to die someday of something. That's the other thing that's bothering me. Okay. Oh, people are so tired of hearing this from me. Is that I'm 77. Okay. I'm make no bones about it. I should say I'm 70 and maybe I might get a job, you know, but I don't. I lie about it. Okay. I don't look a day over. You don't look a day over 50, Alex. Oh, fuck you. But what was I going to say? I read all this material and they say, well, the reason why we don't give people PSA tests, or we shouldn't, is because if you're 75, you know, your life expectancy is only another 15 years. That started to depress me.
Yeah.
Because like, I have this fear of death. I don't know about you, but I have this.
We both do. Huge.
Huge fear of death, okay? And I know one day I'm not going to exist, and that I don't understand, you know, basically because I've always existed. So I suddenly have gone through this whole thing about my life expectancy is only at best 15 years, you know. I mean,
come on. Less time than 9/11 happened.
Exactly. And on top of that, everybody around me is dying. I mean, every day I read about somebody else I knew who dropped dead. So, you know, all this has gotten together, combined with my yearly doctor's appointments, with you know, a depression about it to begin with, survivor's guilt. And secondly, why is everybody around me dying? I used to have a couple of, but like what I call three best friends. And the reason I say three best friends, because I don't take friendship lightly. You know, like you're a good friend of mine, but, you know, and our
We're
a continent apart, and we probably would be best friends if we were closer. Okay.
Yes.
But we're not because we're not close. So I had like three best friends. And then I have a business manager who's been a friend of mine forever. I don't know if I think I consider him a best friend, but it's a business best friend, okay? But outside of that, all my best friends except for one are dead. And you know, I only have one, you know, really best friend. And I was telling this to him the other day. I said, so you better not fucking die on me. You know, luckily he's in his early 60s. So his chances of going are, well, I don't know. I had this guy, Alan Combs, go at 61. So, oh, what the hell? What are we talking about? It's so depressing.
I know. There must be some people like that. We can't be the only two that are obsessed about this.
We are the only two that are obsessed about this. But anyway. Oops. Uh-oh. There goes my phone. And there goes my watch. And there goes my iPad. You hear what happens when somebody tries to call? And I know that it's... Here's what it is. It's one of those robocalls. It's one of those, you know, calls that tell you that they've got something to sell you. Because I have one of these phones that the cable company gives you that you never use. And I have it so it rings those things. So I hear it ring first, and then I hear the other ones ring. I know not to answer it.
Good.
Yeah. So how's your health since you went to all these doctors, or you're going to all these doctors?
I've got the cataract, is not ready. I think you said it has to get ripe.
The term is ripe. I got that from
right. Ripe. So yeah. It's still too mild, so that's going to stay for a while.
Yeah.
I've injured my shoulder without injuring it. It hurts. I don't know why I did to it. They said that happens when you get older. And I still, this hernia thing is, it's hurting, but I think about it all the time, but I don't want to get surgery, so I don't know what to do with that.
Yeah, well, the hernia I've got, my doctor finally looked there and said, yeah, you got a hernia. I see a bulge there. Okay.
Yeah, so he did confirm it.
He confirmed it. He said, you know, and if you want to go somewhere, go to your, gastroenterologist. That's the field that they deal with. And he said, make sure your doctor is one who doesn't want to operate immediately, you know. And what I found in the last couple of weeks, since I've been worrying about my prostate, that hasn't bothered me at all. You know, in fact, I walked 3 miles yesterday, and because it was a nice day, and I decided to walk home from the doctor. And I didn't have any pain or anything. So I think it's, you know, it has its days. But,
and he seemed to think you had said not to worry about strangulation or anything.
Well, he doesn't know about that. My guy is a heart guy. My GP is my heart guy. Is a heart guy. So he's always worried about my cholesterol, which was zoom sky high. And he couldn't figure out.
Really,
why.
You always had low. I had high. What? How bad was it?
300 something.
Jesus, really?
Yeah. Yeah.
How could that happen?
I have no idea. Neither could he, because I'm on cholesterol-lowering drugs. So I've been on this diet, and I said, you know, I fasted 12 hours before the thing. And he said, well, what did you have to eat the day before? I said, oh, bacon and eggs. And the day before, bacon and eggs. He says, that's probably what drove it up.
That's it.
Because according to my cholesterol report, I should be having lard in my veins. What was it? They say that if you have really high cholesterol, it's very hard to keep it down. And David Letterman had a line once. He said, I used to get high cholesterol just from eating pocket lint. You know, it's just that some people have high cholesterol. And again, you know, another one of those things where you go, what is the relationship of cholesterol to heart problems? Obviously, my blood pressure is rock solid. So if I've got 300
cholesterol... That's the most important thing in your chart, your blood pressure.
Really?
Yeah, it's much more important than cholesterol or anything.
Yeah, because if I had really high cholesterol, legitimately high cholesterol, and this jumped about 150 points, you know, in a year... If I had literally had that kind of cholesterol, wouldn't I have high blood pressure too?
If you had any type of blockage in the artery, you'd definitely have high blood pressure because it'd be working harder to get the blood through.
I was like 120 or 110, I can't remember which, over 80.
That's perfect.
Yeah, that's perfect. In fact, it's the best my blood pressure has been. And I said to him, I said, you know, maybe this cholesterol problem is because of my low carbohydrate diet and eating all this meat and everything. And I said, what do you want me to do? Eat the meat, eat the fats, and lose 55 to 60 pounds? Or would you rather I be 55 to 60 pounds heavier and have good cholesterol? And he said, the weight is more important, you know, than anything. Mm-hmm. And this is a heart doctor. So, but anyyway. So, you know, here we are talking about medicine again. Bubs and Alex both get home. You know,
I would take another don't eat the bacon for a day and have another cholesterol draw, but I think that was just an anomaly.
We're going to do it in 3 months. But here's the thing. Do you ever get together with people you're the same age as you for dinner?
Yeah.
Okay. What conversation usually always is part of the conversation?
It's always health issues.
Yes. As I've gotten older, and I hang out, my wife has older friends, and we get together and we have dinner, eventually, at some point during the dinner, it comes to health.
Oh. Yeah, it's not women or career. It's what pills you're taking.
Yeah, it used to be. I love the days when it was, oh, who are you fucking lately? Man, that was, those were the days. But now you.
Those days are gone.
Yeah, so not what, who are you fucking, but how's your cholesterol? And how's it fucking with you? Anyway,
my HDL.
my HDL is mayonnaise. Okay, and anyway, hey, good talking to you again. This is, I don't think it's been depressing. I think it's been enlightening for the people out there, for the younger people who can't understand what we're talking about. Don't worry, you'll be talking about it someday too.
It will someday, yeah.
Bubs, thank you.
Thanks for having me,
buddy.
Let's
do it again next week, okay?
Okay.
Okay, Larry.
This is GabNet, the Great American Broadcast Network. Talk radio like you've never heard it before. Ladies and gentlemen, the history of talk radio. Political opinions have been a staple of radio since the early 1920s. Talk radio as a listener participation format has existed since at least the mid-1940s. WMCA New York's Barry Gray was born with playing music and put a telephone receiver up to his microphone to talk with band leader Woody Herman. This was soon followed by listener call-ins. In 1948, disc jockey Alan Courtney began a call-in program on WGBS Miami. The Alan Courtney Open Phone Forum was a conservative and anti-communist political forum with coverage area over the Southeast United States and Cuba. In the 50s, Joe Pyne, John Neble, and Gene Shepard were among the first to explore the medium. In recent years, talk radio has gained popularity with many new formats flourishing, including all sports in 1986 with the birth of WFAN New York. The subject matter for these formats are different, but the structure has remained the same for all these years. You might say, talk radio is a 20th century format, until now, that is. It's 2014, and radio pioneer and innovator Alex Bennett introduces the Citizen Panel on GabNet, the first revolutionary idea in the format since its inception. The Citizen Panel allows for an open discussion to take place between the host and many listeners all at the same time. Listeners claim that it's addictive, producing stimulating discussions on any topic from politics to movies and entertainment. It's not liberal or conservative. It's open to all opinions and ideas. Log on to GabNet.net to listen and find out how you can participate. Listen to the programs on GabNet and take a step into 21st century talk radio.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Ramble, part two. Thank you so much, Bubs. Bubs is with us at least once a week. And last night we had a problem with his presentation, so we had to rerun it again today, because last night was just an absolute disaster. Okay? All right. Anyway, listen, it's time to open up the Skype lines, and let me do that. Let me make sure that, people are thumbing me up. On our Facebook feed, which is one of the feeds. If you go to Facebook, my Facebook page, Facebook.com/A Bennett, you will get Alex Bennett, and you will get our wonderful. I'm trying to do two things at one time here, so let me. And it's something that's dangerous for me in this day and age, but anyway, I'm trying to. I'm trying to get everybody together here. But anyway, all I have to say is, okay, if you go to facebook.com/A Bennett, you can see the program video-wise live, okay? I can't do anymore? I can't do two things at once. What is wrong with me? Oh, wait a minute. I got to stop the theme. Where is that music coming from? There we go. Stop it. Okay, here we go. All right, I've got to open this up so people can start calling, and so we'll have voices on the air and so on. And, hey, we haven't heard from him. We haven't heard from Rob Alfano in a coon's age, which is about 2 days. Hey. You know, but that's how long coons usually live. So, yeah. So let me go over here, and we'll cut over to you. And there he is, ladies and gentlemen, lying in his bed.
Yes, relaxing.
Now, where are
a long couple of days?
You're in the in a hotel, right?
No, I'm home.
You're home. Wait a minute.
I'm home.
Oh, I thought you were going to a hotel.
Not tonight. No, you know what? I was supposed to be in North Carolina, but yeah. It got canceled, so I am home.
Oh, I see. Okay. Who was I talking? Oh, today I was doing an interview, which will be on in a couple of weeks, actually, with Stephen Pearl. And he said the worst place he's ever worked was South Carolina.
Ah.
He said they were so, they had people walk out, you know, and he isn't a political comic. You know, they just didn't like what he had to say because it didn't fit their political correctness.
Well.
Wow.
I haven't been to South Carolina. I just drove through it to go to Florida a couple of times, but one place I've never really been. You know, I heard you talking to Bubs about the doctor, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I had my physical on Friday, last Friday. And I was so annoyed because on my way to the physical, I was listening to the news and I'm hearing all about what's going on with North Korea and all that.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Okay, there you are.
Yeah.
So I get into the doctor's office and the nurse is doing the, you know, blood pressure and she's, you know, weighing me and doing all that stuff. And she says to me, you know, according to your chart here, you're due for a booster for tetanus and some other thing that I never heard of.
Yeah.
And I said, what the hell is that? And she handed me, they have a ring binder in there, and she handed me what the definitions of these things. All three of them said, this is a very rare disease, blah, 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 in the first sentence of all three. And so I looked at her and I said, you know, on my way over here, I was listening to the news and I heard all about what's going on in North Korea right now. And quite frankly, this is extremely rare conditions. I think we have a better chance in the next 18 months that we won't be here, let alone me worried about having this booster shot.
Did I get tetanus? I can't remember. I mean, a tetanus shot. I've never had tetanus, and I don't know if you know anybody like I know anybody who ever got tetanus. Phil, you ever know anybody that got tetanus?
No, but they wish I would, because I guess you get lockjaw if you get tetanus.
Yeah.
Right, you do.
They used to call it lockjaw, yeah. But, I mean, when I was a kid, they said, don't do that. You have rusty nail, could get tetanus, you know. And everybody was afraid of getting tetanus. And there wasn't a single kid I ever knew that got tetanus. Maybe they
very,
were.
Very, very rare. And then there was another
I think I had a couple of kids out with scurvy, but not tetanus. You know?
They die first.
Yeah.
Just, you know what, there's that. And then he asked me again about the colonoscopy. And so what I have downstairs
is a 20-inch pipe, and you're thinking of doing it yourself.
No, I have that kit that you see the commercial for.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the poop kit?
Yeah.
Yeah, but that does, wait a minute. I'm going to have to do the hang up and then call back people thing tonight.
Yeah.
Let's see here. Call Skype. There we go. We'll call Kevin back. If you call tonight for some reason, because I don't know, something went bazonkers here. Hi there, Kevin. We're going to have to call you back. So if you ring us, you will hear me hang up on you. I may hang up on you. And just be ready, because I'm going to call you right back so I can put you on the line, okay? All right.
Anyway, it rings, then it says it's busy, and
yeah.
Wait a second, then you get the call back.
While you're listening to the busy?
Yeah.
Really? Oh, okay.
There's no, I don't hear a busy. It's just, it stops.
Yeah.
You know, it just rings, stops. You get a thing that says busy.
Yeah.
And.
Anyway, where were we, Roberto?
No, I was just telling you, I got one of those kits, you know?
Oh, yeah.
So you got to poop on this thing or whatever. I haven't opened it yet.
Yeah.
And send it in, and then they'll tell you if you've got colon cancer or the...
Well, I wouldn't trust that completely. Okay.
Well, again, no one in my family has ever had it. So I'm not one of these people I believe, and I told my doctor this, I don't believe in all kinds of medication, and I got caught up in all the medication I was taking for the depression and stuff, and in the end, all it did was screw me up. So now I'm just on my one pill again, and that's it for my thyroid.
Okay, that's but it. Let me try and convince you. What can I do to get you into a colonoscopy?
You will never get me into a colonoscopy.
Well, what is your problem with it is what I want to know.
Because I don't believe in it. I think it's an invasive procedure for nothing.
You know, Tony just tried to call us using the wrong way.
I got it.
I think he's on the wrong line.
He called using one of the previous things.
Yeah, he did that. I got it, too.
Yeah. He should know better. You know, he should know better. Phil, I mean, Tony, screw off, okay? Don't do this. It's not good. It's not
just
good.
Just call him. It's easier than having him call back all night.
Huh? What? I don't want. Why do I want to call him? Hold on a second. I don't even know where you guys are. There you go. I'm trying to. Excuse me, folks. If on the TV you're getting all kinds of weird gazorchness.
If you don't call him, he'll write me 300 notes.
Well, no, but fuck him. If he doesn't know how to call the show after doing it 80 billion quadrillion times. Plus, I don't even have his phone number here. I have him down in my contacts, but I'm not going to go looking for that, you know.
It's under Anthony.
Yeah, I know.
Anthony.
Yeah. And he probably won't answer if I call. Let me see here. No, I don't have a way I can call him. But here comes Jeff Stein, so I will hang up on Jeff, and then I will call Jeff, okay? Add to group call. There we go. And Jeff will be joining us. Anyway, but, you know, here's the reason you should get a colonoscopy, all right? It is, to begin with, a lot of fun. You'll really enjoy yourself.
Especially the prep.
By the way, are you there, Jeff?
Yes.
Oh, okay. I just want to know you're there.
It's a crappy job.
Not if you do the prep properly.
And Renee, turn on your camera, would you?
I'm working on my screen. Okay. Yes, I can do that.
Okay, there so, we go. Tell him why he should get a colonoscopy.
Yeah, you know what? So let's do this. Let's do this.
It's preventable.
First off, it is preventable, and if this makes you feel any worse, you're acting like Phil. You're acting like you can see inside your body and that you know more than a doctor knows.
Yeah.
Now, do you want to be in that category?
No. I'm not going for a colonoscopy. That much I know. So I guess I'm in that category.
Well, Jeff, turn on. Can you turn on your camera? Are you having trouble?
Sure.
Trouble.
So, sorry. Rob, the other thing is the last time I had my colonoscopy, I got the child scope, and it was a whole lot smaller.
I'm not worried about the thing they put up your butt.
You don't even know about it.
Through the whole night before, yeah. You don't even know about that.
The
I'm not
stuff
worried
the night
that.
Before is just a lot of pooping. That's all.
Yeah.
But all I'm saying is that I found that, to begin with, the process itself, they give you a drug. It's the stuff that killed Michael Jackson, as a matter of fact.
It's great that you have that in you.
For a millisecond. You get the most incredible high. The trouble is you pass out before you can really enjoy it. You know?
I agree with that. But the other statement I was going to make was, aren't you planning to move to another country in the, 5 or 10 years?
If the country still exists, yes. I'm a doomsday guy, so I think the world is going to end. Alex thinks he's going to die from prostate cancer, whatever. I believe we're on our way to nuclear war. So,
yeah. And you're talking to somebody who's living closer to North Korea than you are, so you've got to be a little quiet there.
I'm with you, Renee. I'm with you.
The Hawaiian Islands, I understood, was further away from any other country in the world. It was the most isolated island because I think it's closer to the West Coast than it is to Hawaii because of its proximity south.
Yeah.
What is?
That Hawaii is the Korea.
Okay, yeah. So I don't know. We're just the first striking distance. Okay, but
before we get into any of that, because Phil will always careen us off into a ditch.
How about Paris?
I want to finish. I want to finish
with Rob.
Rob, the only reason I'm trying to sell you on a colonoscopy is I love you, you know, and I don't want to see you die of ass cancer. Okay. because if you think you're going to poop a lot the night before a colonoscopy, get ass cancer. Okay. You'll be shitting your brains out.
Well, then they take it and they bypass it, don't they? Is that how it works?
Oh, but yeah, and then they give you a bag you can walk around with. You know, it's very convenient. You don't have to sit on a toilet anymore. You just dump it into the toilet.
Yeah.
Yes. Jeff.
My wife had it today.
The colonoscopy?
Yeah, this morning.
Yeah.
And on a scale of 1 to 10, it's like a 3.
Yeah.
It's really low. And you only have to do it. And you said you don't have it in your family. And the other thing is if you have Stellar Insurance right now, why not get it done before Trump rips the hell out of your court, out of Miss
You want to.
You might not have good insurance in a year.
You want to talk about disgusting. Okay. This is Tim. So I got to hang up on Tim. And now I hope Tim doesn't. I hope I don't get from Tim what I got before was. This person is not here right now, or I'm not here right now. So, Tim, if you're listening, pick up your goddamn phone. There you are. Are you there, Tim?
No. Yeah, I got the busy signal, and you call me back.
Yeah. Okay, good. Because the last time I called you back, because you were on a phone, it was like, hi, this is Tim. I'm not here right now. You know.
I do have Charter internet phone, so who knows what's going to happen with that.
Yeah, yeah.
But the last time we had colonoscopies,
yeah,
my wife and I.
Yeah. What did you do? What did you do? Do them together?
Michael Jackson.
Huh?
Yeah, a couple weeks apart, but the same place.
Yeah.
It was an outpatient center like, who's the lady that died during a colonoscopy?
Oh, the comedian?
Yeah.
Joan Rivers.
That wasn't a colonoscopy.
It was a surgery center.
They were doing a thing with her throat.
But they gave us Michael Jackson
her throat, her throat.
But let me tell you a little story, Tim. About 2 years ago, girlfriend had to get because she's got all kinds of little things. I think what she had to get was actually a look at her esophagus or whatever. And so she went.
It comes from the top down.
Yeah. Endoscopy. Yeah, I want to get an endoscopy, a colonoscopy, and a cystoscopy all at the same time and see if they could see each other. You know. But anyway, I'm not going to explain that joke. If you don't understand it, go get yourself a medical book. Okay. Anyway, here's the point. She goes to this hot place, and I go to pick her up because they want you to pick her up because you know she's been drugged. Okay. And I'm.
You know what drug they use, Alex?
Propofol.
The same thing with Michael Jackson.
Michael Jackson was using it to put himself to sleep. Fucking idiot, you know.
I had no problems with that. I loved it.
There's 1 second. It's only a millisecond that you really feel that buzz, and then the next thing you know, the doctor is going, "Well, everything was fine." But anyway, the point I'm making is, she went to this. You know, because they don't really do it in their doctor's offices anymore. They go to these places that have been built. That are medical centers that you know, where they just do little operations like this. And I'm sitting there and I'm saying, there's something about this place that seems familiar to me. And it turns out, and I remembered it several weeks earlier, Joan Rivers had died there.
Oh, same one then.
Okay. Yeah. And she was getting a similar procedure. And I'm now wringing my hands and hoping she's okay, and they're not going to come out and say, oh, and by the way, she's at Mount Sinai right now, you know.
Damn.
It's like taking selfies with her and stuff like that.
This isn't good stuff, Tim, because we're trying to convince Rob to have a colonoscopy, and this is every reason he shouldn't.
But we had excellent service for the last two times. We had one in Detroit, one north of Detroit, so no problem.
Yeah.
But, it's not.
And I have two friends that died of colon cancer, too.
Well, it is.
If you get this in Detroit, does that mean you get mugged and a colonoscopy at the same time?
Hey, listen.
You'll get a freak tiger's hat.
I'll tell you what was unpleasant when I got a cystoscopy.
I got one of those.
Oh, they're disgusting.
Which one is that?
That's the one where they literally stick an anaconda up your penis.
No, I got a cyst. I got the not the colonoscopy.
Yeah, those are bad.
What's the one that's short of the colonoscopy?
Oh, that's the cystioscopy. Cystioscopy.
It's sigmoid.
The sigmoidoscopy.
That for hernias?
No, that's for
what it is. It looks at the first third of your colon, but that's not where the cancer usually happens.
Right.
Really?
Yeah. My guy, he goes all the way into my small intestine. He gets all the way up there. He really roto-rooters me out.
Yeah.
Hey, Rob, just think, when you get done, you feel so accomplished. Mm. You feel good. You're light on your feet.
We actually take a fiber supplement.
You did it.
For years.
Drug. Rob, so what is your box telling you? What do you have to do?
I don't know. I haven't opened it yet. It's still sitting on the steps.
I did it in January.
Did what?
The thing that Rob's got.
The mail-in deal?
Yeah.
Oh, that's a duty checker, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, you could wind up having blood in your stool, but that doesn't mean you have cancer, although it could mean you have cancer.
Something else that they
They do like a, they check,
DNA,
cells, the DNA.
You know, I'm sure there's going to be a day and age where you won't have to go through all these processes, you know.
Yeah, when I'm dead.
it seems, you know, when I as growing up, I never went to the doctor. I never went to a doctor. I think I, you know, occasionally went to a doctor when I came down with the clap, if I may be so bold, you know.
Yeah, but you were younger. You know, they test you after 50.
No, but what I'm saying is, as I got older, I became an annuity for doctors. You know, I walk in the door and I say, I've got my pee is hurting. Yeah, and then they'll go to themselves, well, let's see, the yacht needs a payment. Okay, yeah, come on. Oh, hey, you know, you need a cystoscopy. This one doctor, I started calling him Dr. Cysto because he did two of them on me, two. He loved doing that. You know, and you go in there, you lie there, and they've got this big giant thing they're going to put in your dick, but they've got it covered nicely with a little piece of cloth. Yeah. You know. But you can see under the cloth, it's gigantic. And at some point, it's coming out anyway. You know?
You could put that on red tube. You know, double ender.
What? Double ender? Yeah.
We had him pull another trick on us this week.
What?
I made a dental appointment. He was on the PPO. I get home, and a week later, they call me that I owe him an extra $100. I go online, and they're no longer PPO.
Ooh.
They're out of network overnight.
Really?
So I'm gonna
Well, wait a minute. When you did it, were they in network?
But I didn't print it and I didn't save it. But that's the only way I look for dentists is directly off my MetLife. It's something I pay for.
Oh, dentist. This is a dentist you're talking about.
Right. I've had the same problem with Blue Cross, but I printed it that time and I fought them and got them to pay an extra $600 because their list online was wrong, and they fixed it, but I went to the one that was up there. So I've won a case before, but I won't win this one.
Yeah.
But that's another trick they pull. What about the new bill they want to pass for the health care?
The new bill they want to pass for health care? Yeah. Tell us about it. You're the one who watches every newscast known to mankind.
Well, I was driving all day, but Dylan Scott has said that the old one was a zombie Trump care, and this would be considered vampire health care. It's that much worse.
Yeah. I thought he just extended the health care for veterans is what he did just yesterday.
No. We're talking about the health care bill that they want to get passed in the House before the 100th day.
Never happened.
If it's going to be anything like what he's doing for veterans, he said, if you live more than 40 miles away or you can't get an appointment for 30 days, then go to a regular doctor and they'll pay for it.
It's very, very complicated. Most doctors don't take it. It is very complicated. I've even talked to the Washington Post. They need to give those veterans Medicare cards temporarily when they can't get in. That choice program. I have doctors in our hometown that won't take workers' comp. They are not going to take a health plan that they don't have any association with. Very hard to find doctors that'll take a choice.
Yeah, you know, there are some doctors today. I mean, you forget about Obamacare, forget about Medicare, forget about all this. There are some doctors who just don't take anything. They just say, here's what I'm charging you. Go get as much as you can from your health care provider. Yeah. You know.
And Steve Phelan Unger had a show today about that. That and the veterans care. A lot of compliments of the veterans care. Some problems, but there was a lot of people that really liked Obamacare.
Well,
I don't want that to go away.
You know, I think Obamacare was a beginning at solving the health insurance crisis, but it's not a way of making sure that people are all in good health. I mean, that could only be done with single payer. Okay.
Right. Well, I think I gave a suggestion to Steele and Unger.
Who's Steele and Unger?
Michael Steele
Yacht
and
couple.
Rick Unger. They have a serious show.
Oh, I don't give
they're
a
pretty good.
Please don't even mention that name in my presence. Okay.
Oh, I apologize. But the suggestion is these insurance companies make money in each state processing Medicare and Medicaid claims. Very, very profitable contracts. The government, and I'll put this on the Facebook later.
Another thing on my Facebook page for people to read?
If they want to read it, that's fine.
But it's on my Facebook page.
If you want to Medicaid...
Morning.
Huh?
No, Alex!
The comments under your picture, so.
Yeah.
There's a comment.
Well, the comments under my picture go, boy, isn't this guy ugly.
I would not post anything to your wall.
Yeah.
No, so what happens, what Alex doesn't see is when we watch... on Facebook, you get the picture of all of us, and then to the right of it, we are allowed to start talking, and mm-hmm. so we talk back and forth.
Yeah,
but Alex
has a chat box too, I think.
Right, and Alex doesn't read any of that.
Well, the trouble is, it's in back of me.
Right
now, I do have a new program that I got today that actually shows me stuff that is being messaged to me.
We can do a test. Like tomorrow.
Yeah. No, I had the program up and I should have just kept it out, you know, because it allows me to take, you know, like the messaging and just see it. And I could put it like right over here so I could see it
right
to the side.
So yesterday when I asked him to post, he posted on that exact area so I could hit on the link and read it.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it wasn't posted to your Facebook page.
Oh, okay.
It's in the chats underneath your actual post of the video.
Yeah.
Yeah. Why don't you let us post pictures on there? But anyway, let me finish real quick. So if you want a contract in Ohio...
Post porn on there if you want to. Let's make it interesting, you know.
But I get taken down.
Well, okay. It's not my fault if somebody does it. You know, they can't blame me.
Right. Yeah. I'll try to, knowing Fuckerberg. I can't stand that son of a bitch, that smug little bastard.
You know something? I love Brian because Brian just is
direct. He's direct.
He's direct.
I like Zuckerberg. Yeah. I like Zuckerberg.
He lets you know about it.
Yeah.
He's what your intro talks about.
What?
You know, you can have open opinions. Right.
Yeah.
Brene, you were saying you like Zuckerberg?
Okay, so I like Zuckerberg better than I like Ellison.
Well, I mean Zuckerberg.
I don't
know. Zuckerberg. Ellison's a fucking asshole.
I'll give you that.
Oh, yeah,
At least he brought something. He may have stolen the idea of Facebook, but at least he brought it into fruition, something practical and somewhat practical.
You know,
Ellison the Oracle guy?
Yeah, he's an Oracle guy. He's the guy who brags about how much money he spent to put koi fish in his koi pond. You know, he's an asshole. He's the asshole of all assholes.
I was thinking of Keith Ellison.
You know,
I thought that was Trump.
So far, Zuckerberg, you really have a hard-on for Zuckerberg. Well, I'm not in a good way. You have a hard-on for Zuckerberg. And what is that based on? You know, it's not that he stole it. He was one of three guys that came up with it. And he pretty well screwed the other two out of it, but he didn't steal it.
He paid him $160 million.
That was they took it. They shouldn't have taken it. They should have just waited, stalled a little bit.
Not much different than how Microsoft and Apple were developed.
No, it's not.
Yeah, I mean, you will find in the technology business that most people who are successful stole whatever they, you know. It's just unfortunate that that's the case. But
I saw on the Gabnet thing, you're laying claim to podcasts now.
That's right.
You know.
Yeah. Well, no, but I can prove it.
Yeah.
Yes.
All right.
What do you mean, all right?
Well, you know, the statute of limitations is run.
I know I'm never going to see a cent out of it, but I figured we may as well brag that we've been doing podcasts since 1997, and there was nobody doing... here's what we came up with, I and this other guy. I was not working. We wanted people to be able to get a little taste of Alex Bennett. So I would do a little, like, 30-minute show on my website. And he said, here, I just invented a little program. It's called Auto Alex. And all people have to do is take this program, turn it on their computer, and once a day it will go over to your site and download your show. What does that sound like?
Sounds like iTunes.
Yes, doesn't it? Sounds like podcasting.
Napster. It sounds like Napster.
It sounds like podcasting, and that's exactly what it was. Absolutely. But we didn't know we had invented it.
You took the podcast and then downloaded it, which is like iTunes. You put podcast out there.
Yeah,
and
but most podcasts, Phil, aren't live.
It's like RSS feeds.
Yeah, well, if you download it daily, was your podcast live?
Was it live? No. I recorded it, and then it sat there until you downloaded it.
Right.
But most podcasts are pre-recorded.
Yes.
You know, when you go to iTunes and get this program tonight off of iTunes, it's a podcast. It's an RSS feed. Yeah.
I thought you were waiting around to do it live every time somebody wanted to hear it.
Yeah, I just sat by my phone, and the light went on. Somebody's listening. Hi, how are you? No.
Yeah, that's how I thought it worked.
We did, however.
How much did you charge, Alex?
We did, however, do the shows live later on when we were playing TV.
Right.
And I'd do the show from 2 to 4 every day, and it was a total video show.
Was that downloadable or no?
We didn't have that, so it was downloadable later on. We just kept playing it later on in the day on the network, so you could pick it up at any, various times. So,
hey, can we do your show on Snapchat so we can all be made to look like famous brilliant minds of history?
No.
Like Meeting of the Minds with Steve Allen?
No. Oh, man, my stomach is killing me.
I'm thinking about getting a green screen and playing around with that, because you can make a green screen work over Skype.
Yeah, you can make a green screen work over anything where you have an output from video.
Do you have a video switcher to do that, or do you have the technology?
No, it's some software, and it's cheap or free. The basic one's free. You can get for $39
Phil,
a screen.
Phil, listen to me. Let me implore you. You're annoying enough as it is.
I could have the Kremlin.
Don't need to have you in pictures of like fish in the background, like there's a tank or something,
The American flag or whatever I want to put there.
Make America great again.
Yeah, I could put Trump. I could put Trump in the background, going like this,
Did you see him on Easter Sunday when his wife had to nudge him to put his hand over his heart for the national anthem?
Yeah. Well, he thought it was being sung for him.
Bill
O'Reilly.
Was it somebody the other day on the show told me about some situation during the Easter egg roll where some kid came over to him with a Make America Great cap and handed it to him so he would sign it, and he signed it. And then he took the hat and flung it into the crowd.
That was Barron's cap, and he took the cap off Barron and threw it into the crowd.
Oh, really?
I think that's what it was.
Okay.
Oh, jeez.
That's what you
said.
Well,
the kid will get another hat.
Yes, Renee. Okay,
this is a stupid question, but is Barron's Trump's and Melania's child?
Yeah.
So Melania actually gave birth to Barron?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. We don't know how that happened exactly, but yes.
Okay.
They can make babies really good in Eastern Europe.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he could have put his stuff in a jar for a couple of years and waited for the next woman to come along who was of childbearing abilities.
The kid has the Trump hair,
Yes. He has a comb over too?
Yes. He has a similar head of hair to Donald.
Can we have a show of hands, Alex? How many people here think Putin was behind the shooting in Paris today?
Oh, come on. It was one of these Ali Akbar guys, and you know what? It's going to do.
Here we go.
Oh, Putin God. Once a far right-wing guy in there, he's going to get his wish.
Well, the right-wing guy is a woman, first of all. Le Pen.
I know. Le Pen. Is it Le Pen?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's Le Pen, and the election is less than a week away. It's sometimes
they're anti-sanctions. They're buddy buddy with Russia on the far right there. So it's just a John Birch Society.
This guy has been known to the government as a if it's the right guy that they think it is. He was in jail for 20 years. They let him out. They knew he was a threat. He had assaulted a police officer 20 years ago. The guy's a nutcase, but they are saying that it was terrorism. You know?
Yeah, well, Trump said that as soon as he heard what happened.
Well, no, the French are saying that.
I understand. But it's just awful good timing because the election is tomorrow, isn't it?
No, in a week.
It's a week? Okay. We'll see what happens.
Mm-hmm. Is anyone else, Brian?
I was just going to ask real quick, is anyone else using the instant message feature on Skype?
On Skype?
Because if you are, I left a nice little Snapchat filter.
Let me see here. People will see this on the side. There's where it is. Yeah.
There it is.
Yeah.
How do you see that? Oh, you go up, there's a little thing.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a little like.
I see it.
Yeah, and he wrote, "What is that management?"
Oh, this could be my Snapchat filter pick.
Okay.
Oh,
can't see it.
It's just management.
Was that
like,
nice, folks? We could do that. Mm-hmm. Also, I can do this. I can use my keyboard now to switch between me and you guys. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, shit. They vote on Sunday.
What?
We can't even get our act together to move our voting over to a fucking weekend.
I know.
But the folks vote on Sunday.
Well, some people work on Sunday and they can't vote.
It's a religious day. You know, Saturday and Sunday. Some people at Friday night. It could be a religious thing.
Yeah. But no, most countries, the elections... You know the Philippines pretty well. What day are the elections in the Philippines? Do you know, Rob?
Whenever they chop the head off of the last leader.
What day are the elections in the Philippines? What day are the elections in the Philippines?
Is it like it's not? I bet it's not Tuesday.
Every 4 years?
Yeah.
But what day? What date?
No. Ask her if it's a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday.
Yeah.
Oh, is it during the week or is it on a weekend?
There you go.
During the week.
During the week.
It's usually a coup d'etat.
Yeah.
Well, now, hang on a second, because a lot of other countries, not only do they have them during the or like ours have them during the week, but they give you, like, some countries give you a month to vote. The polls are literally
open. Well, you really, Renee,
that sounds
in most
excessive and a little bit worrisome.
But in a lot of states, Renee, you now have that ability. I mean, how many people cast their votes early this year?
Oh, yeah. Or by mail.
Or by mail, but there was early voting this year. So really, the voting days wasn't just one day. It was a whole, you know, series of days.
It's not federal, though, which it should be.
Right.
Every states.
I agree.
And then you get to vote and the asshole always gets elected. How's that for, you know?
What's that?
The asshole gets elected. Yes, Jeff.
There's certain locations that are... part of the United States, but they're not states.
Oh, like Guam?
Yeah.
District of Columbia.
And they're allowed to vote quite early.
Yeah, Hawaii.
Often they mail them in and things like that.
Yeah, well, the reason for the Electoral College actually was that they needed a buffer zone for everybody to ride in on their horses to Washington, D.C. with the votes. So that's why we have the Electoral College, I think, sometime in December, is it? And the election is, an early part of November. So
I thought it was so larger states couldn't overrun smaller states and the states would have more of an equal
bullshit.
Footing.
It's bullshit. Well, it was a matter of convenience. How do we get all these votes counted? How do we have people come in and do them?
They don't count them anyway.
Wait a minute, Jeff?
What Phil just talked about, obviously, that's why the states have congressmen and senators.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the senators are all for equally for each state. But
true.
The other ones depends upon the quantity of people who live there.
Well, also the amount of electoral votes they have is equal to the number of congressmen and senators that they have.
Districts.
I vote we change the congressional thing from quantity to quality.
We continue to get Trump reelected.
You mean we have a test?
Listen, Trump may not. Let's be honest about something.
Sarah Palin?
He may not live that long. He's in that. He's in that little. What could we call it? Age group where he could go any day. Okay, and that worries me because I don't want to see that fucker, his vice president, Putz, whatever his name is.
Now, Alex, you've said in the past that you would have preferred Nixon over Trump. Now you're saying that Bush looked pretty good compared to Trump. Pretty soon.
I got news for you. Hitler didn't look bad compared to Trump.
Trump will look good compared to somebody else down the road.
Probably that's the scary
part.
That's
the reason. That's the reason why we all won't be here. You won't be here because your prostate's going to kill you, and Rob won't be here because he's going to get the ass cancer.
There you go.
And the only guy who's going to survive is Jeff because he goes to his doctor all the time to make sure he's in good shape, right, Jeff?
I'm going there tomorrow.
See. I mean, girlfriend even has to kind of.
Wife, now we're giving you shit about not getting a colonoscopy.
No.
Well, he's
roll your head right over there, and let her know that we're giving you shit and that we're on her side.
Well, he just doesn't want to give up shit.
Oh, wait a minute. How's your wife feel about the colonoscopy, Rob?
We don't discuss it.
We don't discuss it.
Plus, you could lose 5 or 10 pounds in one day.
Yeah,
that's true.
It's all water weight.
Yeah, but you know
that's so.
You know what you worry about though when you do the cleanse before the colonoscopy, is that you do it in two sections. You do one, and then you poop like crazy, and then the next morning you do another cleanse, and you're hoping that all of this is going to stop before you have to get in a cab or a car and go to get your colonoscopy. Because you don't want to poop your pants. That would be terrible. But somehow they've got it worked out so that doesn't happen.
That's because you're done with the pooping before you wake up in the morning.
Yeah, but you have to do another cleanse before you.
Right. By the time you hit your second cleanse, there's really nothing there.
Yeah.
It's like the dry heaves.
If you decide to do it at some point, Rob, get a hold of me and I'll tell you what kind of cleansing stuff you should use. I got this stuff, which comes in a little bottle. And it just cleanses. It's better than having to drink like this. Some have people have this thing where they take a gallon of stuff and have to constantly swill it over a period of time. This is like a little thing. I can't remember what it's called, but I still got a bottle of it in the refrigerator. And I hope nobody drinks it thinking it's a soda. You know,
that'd be a cruel joke.
Yes, it would be a cruel joke.
I think in July.
What? Tim was trying to say something.
Was it a powder or a liquid?
It was a liquid. It's a liquid.
Okay, because I think my daughter had one. They used Miralax.
No, well, Miralax, they have you take Miralax too. That's
okay.
But what I could run to the refrigerator and see what it's called.
I've seen it before.
But you can get it at any drugstore, and
is it citrate of magnesium?
Yes,
yeah,
magnesium citrate. You're absolutely right, Rob. And I put it in with some like ginger ale or whatever, and drink it. Doesn't taste bad or whatever. And
I thought it tastes like I thought that tastes like 7-Up.
It
or soda water.
It let me put it this way: if you just drink it all down, you put it in with some stuff, and you drink it all down, you don't taste anything. It's pretty damn good. The other stuff is like supposedly a gallon of stuff, and you have to take like every 15 minutes another glass of it, another glass, and another glass. I just rather do it this way, you know.
That's like being waterboarded.
Well, my doctor prescribed the gallon of stuff to me, and I said, but the last time he had me take this magnesium citrate, and he went, oh, okay, you can do that too. And I said, thank you very much, you know. And the next, and he did the same thing this time that he did to me the time before. He said, did a very nice job of cleaning yourself out. And I figured I
first sigmoidoscopy, they sent me home because I wasn't clean enough.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, sigmoidoscopy, you just use an enema, use a Fleet enema.
Well, that, but I also had to drink this stuff and evacuate.
You should. The sigmoidoscopy, to begin with, I want to know who sigmoid is.
Because sigmoid fluoride, right?
No. I think it's named after somebody.
Yeah.
And I would hate to think that I had something that goes up your ass named after me.
I think he was an asshole.
An Alexoscopy, you know.
Let's see.
Anyway. As long as we're in medical things, boy, my knee is still killing me.
You just want her drugs.
Wear knee pads next time.
It's really stiff. It's really stiff and hurts. What?
Have you elevated it?
No.
All day?
No.
Have you iced it all day?
No.
Have you been taking aspirin?
He didn't tell me to do any of that.
Yeah, ice it.
God damn it, rest, ice, compression, and elevation.
Elevation. Okay. Yeah. But anyway, so now I got what?
You know, you're getting to the point where Diana's going to come in and kick your ass. Is what's going to happen.
No, here's what happened. I told girlfriend tonight, I said, I'm limping so much, I look like a dog who's just been yelled at. You ever have a dog that, like, when you yell at him, he starts fake limping?
Yeah, they crawl away.
Yeah.
They know they've done something wrong.
Yeah. Dogs. What salesman? So I think it was the guy who was the big animator over at Warner Brothers who said that he loved doing dogs because they're the world's best salesmen.
Yeah.
And they're always selling you something, dogs, you know. Cats are always stealing something from you, and that's why I like them, you know. Anyway, let me see here. I was trying to think about, we got to have the whole thing with, what's his name from Fox? I forget his name.
Bill O'Reilly.
Yes, I forget his name because it's been so long since he's been on the air. Bill O'Reilly. I was starting to get feeling sorry for him. I read that he was going to get $25 million as a parachute out of the place.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Dale's got 40, and what's her name? Patrick likes. She got 24 million.
Megyn Kelly.
Yeah, but she had to threaten to sue to get that.
Yeah.
They're spending a lot of money to get rid of people.
Yeah, and I saw an interview today with a couple of ex-CNN babes who were on CNN. A couple of ex-Fox babes who were on CNN, and both of them said that they'd experienced. That one was there 15 years and talked about some of the craziness that went on, and they said this is just the tip of the iceberg because there's a lot of management. Nothing has really changed over there yet.
Yeah. So you know what? It has to be. For every female that you ever meet that says they work at Fox Television, that news, a portion of it, you need to say, damn, that must have been a shitty job. Because you know if Roger Ailes is doing this and then Blowhard this and then Blowhard that is doing it, that it's just in trickle-down bullshit. And the women in there must be able to, like, put a body camera on them and just have a lawyer sit there and go, yeah, that's against the law. Yeah, that's misogynistic. Yeah, they can't tell you that. It would be hilarious if somebody mic'd someone up and let them run around all day on Facebook so we can watch it.
Yeah, well,
I heard from that Wendy Walsh, the last woman to come forward on Bill O'Reilly. She says she doesn't want any money and that she just wanted to, make it known. And she's not a bad-looking gal. And, you know, she's a single
mom.
That's
a nice way to talk about somebody who's yelling about sexual discrimination. And she's not a bad-looking chick, you know. She's all right. I do her.
you know, she's, you know, she but came
she
forward.
She did not negotiate over price, though, right?
Well, no, she came forward because she said it was the right thing to do, and she doesn't want any money, and she's not suing for any money.
Lisa Bloom is not charging any money either. Did you know that?
What?
Yeah, that's
the
right.
The attorney's not charging.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So
she's going to get so many more court cases out of this from all the women at Fox. Is that what you're thinking?
Well, she's a competitor to Gloria Allred.
Yes, it's free advertising. But one of the ladies went to Roger Ailes. And Roger said, I can't do anything about it. He's our biggest OnStar celebrity. I can do nothing about the harassment. We just have to live. Some people are just odd.
Well, there are. No. You know,
which in translation means stupid little woman, go right. away.
The well, no, but
more important.
Brian's giving the finger to the camera, knowing that people can now see him, you know, every night.
Well, you know, it's just that's in translation. Renee's giving the audio translation. I'm giving the visual, visceral
absolutely.
Translation. You're
much
so
powerful.
Full of shit, Roger Ailes. It's no wonder that every time you belch, you shit out a turd.
You know something? If I were a woman at Fox and somehow I was being pressured by Roger Ailes to have sex, just the very thought would make me vomit all over him.
Oh yeah.
I mean, that is, you know, I can think of disgusting.
Then they would charge him extra.
I can think of disgusting people you don't want to fuck, and he's at the head of the list. You know, at least you know Bill O'Reilly. Okay, he's just like an overweight Irishman. You know, but some woman could say, well, I guess I can hold my nose and blow him or something. But with Ailes, I mean, that was really harassment, because to have sex with him would just absolutely, just the thought of it to me just makes me want to vomit.
Yeah, okay, yeah, but he's why is he the one who gets paid off in the end?
So
he's the man.
Well, he got paid off because it probably was in his contract.
That's what
he did make right. Fox but, what it is. And right. a money-making machine for 21st Century Fox.
It's
and
like
he
a Carl
and,
Rove,
and 40, $40 million was a cheap price to pay to get rid of him. Okay?
Yeah, that's true. That's true. But it just seems like that money should be going to all the victims. Just like Bill Cosby, all his money should go to the victims.
Well, you know, I was thinking about this today. Yes, I am sure Bill O'Reilly was not nice to many women and probably did nasty things. All right. Let me just say that out front. But I don't know that all of them that are going to come forward now did, you know, that I think that there's a certain percentage in these situations, like with Cosby. Cosby, I think maybe 50% are just after a good payday. All right. Wait a minute. Let me finish what I'm saying.
Totally incorrect.
Well, let me finish what I'm saying. But even at 50%, even if it were 75% that were lying and trying to get a good payday, that still leaves us with enough people, even if it was one, where it was wrong and bad behavior. So we know that with all those people claiming it, even if you write off a number of them or a large
right.
number of them,
correct.
There is still enough bad behavior that the man shouldn't have a cent left to his name after this is over.
Right, but they've always been in control with power and the money.
Well, apparently not. Apparently not.
Well, but he's made it. He's got all the money he ever needs.
Well, yes, right. But Roger Ailes' days were almost over anyway. He was in his mid-70s, you know, maybe a little older than that. And I don't think his days at Fox were that long anyway. So it was time to retire. So take your $40 million and go find something to do with it. Renee, you had your hand up.
I would like to do a call back to the fact that Alex said he would do Bill O'Reilly before he would do Roger Ailes.
Well, I didn't think I said it that way. But
we're negotiating on price now, Alex.
If I were forced to have sex with one of them, I would definitely choose Bill O'Reilly over Ailes. I mean, I see Ailes on television just, you know, walking down the street on the news, and I want to hurl. I literally want to hurl.
Don't watch him in HD.
Huh? Ugh. Yeah, right. Right. So, you know.
This is a horrifying display for HD.
Yeah. So, you know, Bill O'Reilly, well, Bill O'Reilly says, you know, I'm innocent of everything they're saying, blah, 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 blah.
But he follows the advice of his attorney quite well.
Well, there is the, you know, if you got the money, pay it off so that it goes away, school right. of law. That, you know, that anytime you take something all the way to court, you're taking chances on how it's going to turn out, even if you're innocent. You know,
he's so much like Trump, though, and for that reason.
Yeah, yeah.
And Trump has always lived his life by getting the attorneys that used to work for the mafia out of his problems.
Mm-hmm. Trump,
but it doesn't work on the on foreign affairs. It's not working so well.
Trump doesn't settle.
Pardon?
Trump doesn't
settle. Oh, he doesn't.
He, does settle. Yeah. Don't
he just settled. He just settled.
You know, deal with it as president, and he didn't want to do that.
Oh, wait a minute. Bullshit. He has settled in the past.
He settled with the IRS all the time, Phil. What about, is he going to settle with South Korea when he lied to him about the carrier? And he told South Korea they used to be part of China.
It was called French Indochina. No, that was Vietnam.
It was Vietnam.
Trump is a know-nothing. Has anybody seen Veep yet?
Oh, come on.
What?
What's her name?
Now?
She's the
Julian Louis-Dreyfus?
Yeah.
She's the perfect Hillary. The first episode was excellent.
How many here watch Designated Survivor?
Oh, that's a great show.
You know why I think that show it's a very popular show, is well-liked by America? It's the president we all wish we had.
Yeah.
You know what I did, Alex?
True dad.
I sent a tweet to Ivanka to make Trump sit down and watch the 100-day episode, which was a couple weeks ago, when he was acting very presidential.
Yeah.
Your dad watch this. For a whole hour, watch the whole show and take some online training.
He's the ultimate good guy on this show. I mean, really, if there were a guy like this, all of us would vote for him.
He'd get 100. Al Gore.
Not Al Gore. This guy is just, you know, he's just been put in a bad situation, and he's going to make the best of it. And gosh, I guess as long as I'm here, I better do right by people. And you go, oh God, I wish we had that. And I think it's popular because of Trump. I think that the fact that we have a president that's counter to the kind of guy in this show. You get what I'm saying? You know?
I think he's grown in being a pretty good actor in his older age, though, too.
Oh, yeah.
He's got good writers, which I think is, you know, that's 90% of most shows anyway.
But and they got a little adventure thing going on with it, and it's a good show, very good show. Brian.
Surprised I haven't brought this up in prior conversations concerning politically minded television drama. Who here has watched House of Cards?
Well, we all have, you know.
Every episode.
Yeah, that's more
I think the third season was a little soft, but. You take these shows.
You like Bill because the bad guy who is Kevin Spacey is a Democrat.
Oh, I watched a nice movie last night. That new Adam Sandler one.
God, I saw that. It's horrible.
Those two horrible. Words in one sentence is not how it goes, but go ahead. Adam Sandler in a good movie.
Yeah.
What was the name of that? I watched it last night. Sam somebody, or it was the guy's name.
You must really have liked it to remember the name of it.
Well, yeah, I can't remember the name, but it was a good movie. I enjoyed it.
How is it a good movie?
It was entertaining. He reminded me of Jerry Lewis. I think he was doing a Jerry Lewis when.
No, he's doing every character he ever did.
Yeah.
But
I binge watched the Playboy thing that you suggested.
Isn't that good?
Yeah, about third or fourth one, I think now.
Yeah, it's really very good. It's really good. It's called American Playboy, the Hugh Hefner story, and it's excellent. It's 10 episodes.
I forgot all about that penthouse show. I remember seeing a couple of episodes of that when I was younger.
Penthouse, or that was
Playboy. Playboy's Penthouse Playboy, was the name
Playboy
of the TV show.
Show. Yeah, it was you know, it was like in
Playboy After Dark.
Yeah, but and then Playboy's Penthouse was the show about maybe 10 years later that he did. He came back for two or three seasons or something.
When I used to work at the Playboy Channel, they used to run those old vintage Hefner shows.
Yeah.
That was the Penthouse then, probably. The black and white ones.
The black and white ones
are all available, by the way, on DVD.
Yeah,
and the star quality in those shows were amazing. You know, they were amazing TV shows.
Did anybody ever see those aerobicized ones from the 70s that were like a Busby Berkeley thing? And they were just women exercising, but it was, you know, like the it was like Busby Berkeley, but not in a pool or anything.
What crap do you watch?
Well, it was in the 70s. It was pretty good. It was called aerobicized.
Yes.
Were you on drugs, Phil?
Yes.
Yeah.
The whole time.
That must have been Mystery Science Theater 3000.
No. It was great. You know, it almost looked like a kaleidoscope or something with beautiful women.
You know what movie we need to watch right now, though, with the carrier moving, is 7 Days in May.
Not a bad idea.
Because a lot of generals. I don't know if they're giving the top man all the information.
Hey, you know something?
CIA.
Something just hit me, and I don't know if this is happening, but I'm, you know, we're doing this thing live on Facebook, right? Mm-hmm. I'm wondering if you can go over to, like, I know that you can get Facebook on Apple, for instance. I wonder if you can get this live on your TV using Facebook.
I mean, via Apple television?
Huh?
Possible.
Yeah.
Or connect your computer via HDMI or VGA to an older television that has an VGA input.
Yeah, well, you can
be able to.
Yeah, well, you could also mirror it too.
Yeah,
show up on your TV. Yeah.
Because what we're doing now, I've gotten this to a point now where the video is, if you blow it up on a TV set, it looks great. I mean,
we're just like Don Lemon two nights ago. Just like Don Lemon show, perfect, exactly the same.
Boy, all these TV people, man, they're frying your brain, Tim. All these.
I listen for the experts, and I listen for the.
But they aren't experts. They claim they're experts. They make money being an expert.
They had a former ambassador on today.
All these people.
Former CIA agents. Malcolm Nance is really good. Look up Malcolm Mance on Twitter. He's really good.
Oh, boy.
Right away. Hey, can you use your 4K GoPro as your webcam to put your signal, your video out in 4K?
No. Does that answer your question?
No.
In fact, I really got to start using this camera. I haven't used it. I bought... Look what I got here. See, I mean, I got the camera, and then I bought this thing. This old $300 gadget that I got for my birthday, and which one do I do to start it? Here we go.
You got one of those. I've seen those.
This is a, let me see here. Let's see if it, there it goes.
There it goes.
Wait a minute. Why does it say USB connected? It's not. It's actually like a very smooth. I mean, if I just shoot with this and use it and walk around with it, nothing jumps or bumps or, you know, it's like a what do you call it? Remember Steadicams?
Steadicam. It's got a digital stabilizer.
Yeah, and you see how it stays in one place when I move the camera.
Yeah, you can rotate it and all that.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm going to use this now that it's summertime and I can go out with it, but it's wonderful. It's just wonderful. And it, as you say, it does shoot in 4K as well. But the problem is if I did 4K, the problem would be that it's a lot of people watching it would have trouble watching it because they wouldn't be getting to begin with, the amount of bandwidth it would eat up if you were using your phone and you were just using your phone service to pick it up, it would just be sucking bandwidth like you wouldn't believe. So that's why I wouldn't do it.
Mm.
So anyway, so what else is happening in the news? Tim, you're the news junkie around here. Tim?
Can you hear me? Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
I have my mute on.
Yeah.
Well, you know, Citizens United has been expanded because the FCC is basically leaning toward having bigger TV networks merge and allowing price increases for using the very broadband you were just talking about.
Yeah.
So pretty soon, we don't have free speech unless you're a millionaire. Then you can have free speech.
Well, we don't have free speech now if you're a conservative, because if you want to speak on a college campus,
you're changing the subject. Wait a minute. Hold on a second, Phil. He is in particular talking about the FCC and your access to the internet and your access and my access to doing shows on the internet.
Not Ann Coulter's access to money.
Well, Ann Coulter's another one.
Not Ann Coulter's access to a university. That isn't the issue. That is an institution that can choose who is there and who isn't there, and her ass is gone, probably because she's so less educated than the fucking freshman at Berkeley. It would be an embarrassment to have her speak.
It's just that universities should promote all types of thought. If you're conservative,
universities doing that, why would you force Berkeley to do it?
You're out of your fucking mind, Phil, because you're speaking about particular colleges. There are colleges in the South where they don't invite left wingers to speak. Okay,
well, it's NYU and Berkeley, to name a few.
To name two, but you go into the South and you go to a lot of those
Jerry
Southern.
His Liberty point. University, yeah, I doubt they would.
Yeah, I mean, there are
Has Al Gore ever been invited to any of those shitholes?
He couldn't pay him enough. You know, it's, you know. But
no, now you're making excuses. Phil, it was a bunch of people who didn't like certain people, didn't like their university spending money on certain people to come speak. I'm against that. I think as a very liberal thinking person, a left winger, that I think we could all agree, all of us here who are on the left, that anyone should have the right to speak at a university and perhaps take a payday for it, you know, if that's what the university does, and large.
So to get back to what Tim was saying about the net neutrality and the free speech.
Oh, now you want to get back to that, I see.
Well, the reason I brought up the other one is that free speech is being challenged.
One doesn't have anything to do with the other.
The free speech is the universities, they have the choice in that case. But you have the right to complain about it to them or anybody you want to, but they have the right to make their own decisions.
But outside agitators are coming in and they're being violent. To try to curtail people from speaking.
Outside agitators have controlled Washington for 35 years.
That's correct.
Yeah, they're not hitting people over the head.
Don't talk to me about agitators.
They're not hitting people over the head with bicycle locks like they did.
They want to kill people by taking their health care away and to give the insurance companies more profit. What are you talking
about? Nobody wants to kill people, and nobody's taking the health care away.
That's what they want to do.
Yes, right.
That's they want to make it accessible.
Yeah, that's scary.
You can't afford it, but it's accessible.
Yeah, well, you can, even if they gave you for free, you can't afford it because with a $6,000 or a $13,000 deductible, you can't afford to get sick anyway.
Renee, amendment
to get rid of the risk corridor.
Renee had her hand up.
Phil, if this is a big deal for you, Ann Coulter couldn't talk, and that other
Milo
thing couldn't talk. Why don't you have him go speak at the Commonwealth Club?
Well, I'm sure they either have or could, but the Commonwealth Club invites people from all walks of life.
Sure, Ann Coulter.
I'd love to see Ann Coulter at the Commonwealth Club. Excellent. I would go.
We asked the Commonwealth Club of Northern California was asked who they should bring or asked who they
the
should
problem,
bring in
the problem
from the conservative side of this. And the conservative people said,
"I couldn't
bring in a Kardashian."
Yeah, I couldn't go there. I couldn't go there to watch Ann Coulter, because I would hurl all over Roger Ailes. So you know,
that's a mess, man. That's a mess.
Who's the guy that just came out with? who's the guy that just came out with a book? He was a Trump operative, and he dresses really bad with bow tie and stuff like that. This guy's been in a number of Roger Stone.
Roger Stone.
Yeah, he was supposed to speak at the Commonwealth Club, and I bought tickets for it, and then they canceled it.
Why'd they cancel it?
I don't know.
Did he cancel it?
Probably.
Yeah. Okay. So why did you bring it up? Because it's not a case of somebody.
Well, isn't he being subpoenaed to talk about the Russian thing?
Yep. He said he'd be happy to.
Well, that's probably why he canceled.
Yeah. He was on Bill Maher's show a couple of weeks ago. I found him interesting.
Yeah.
He's an interesting asshole. You know,
I didn't.
Do you know who we're talking about, Jeff? Stone?
Yeah, I watched him on for a few minutes one day.
Yeah.
I haven't paid for the book, but when they canceled it, they refunded all the money.
So Roger Jones is Jerry Springer on acid. That's what he's like.
Who?
So how exactly is it that Republicans are not being allowed to speak their piece? How is
at
this?
At universities.
No, at universities.
Yeah, pardon me? Say again.
Certain universities.
Well, yeah, the universities, when they speak at universities that don't give them any grief, there's no news in that. But when they speak at universities where you have people throwing things that are tantamount to sticks of dynamite.
Let me ask you this. Overturning
cars and setting things on fire.
Years ago, I was at a Broadway show. It happened to be Dudley Moore and Peter Cook. And their beyond their show, I can't remember what the name of it was. And at the end of the show, they came out and they said, by the way, is there a doctor in the house? And everybody laughed because Henry Kissinger was sitting right in front of me. Mm-hmm. Everybody kind of laughed. And he had Kissinger stand up. And when he did, I started booing. And I got tackled to the floor for that.
Good.
What do you mean good? Wait a minute. What do you mean good? You should say that was terrible because I was giving my free speech, and this person was in a theater and because of this war going on in Vietnam, should not be allowed to go anywhere without knowing there is dissent for what he is doing. And that's the same is true when anybody goes to these universities or whatever. You can't just keep quiet. You've got to let them know that they're involved in bad behavior and you don't believe in it.
And what would be so wrong with listening to what they have to say to try to better
understand? I listened all the time to Henry Kissinger. He was on television all the time and I was listening to him. But now he was there and I wanted him to know that he can't just go out for a night at the theater while people are getting killed in Vietnam and think that he can get away with it.
Well, I did attend the Henry Kissinger at the Commonwealth Club and got the book signed. But did somebody say Peru? Because that reminds me that Venezuela is something.
Peru. He worked for the CIA and helped this. I think it was Peru when they took over the country there.
Might be Argentina. Augusto Pinochet, I remember.
Pinochet. Yeah, I think it. Yeah.
A little more timely is what's going on right now in Venezuela. You've got the government melting down. The people are rioting in the streets. They've shut down, and the government has seized the General Motors plant and all the automobiles there. And the whole country is melting down. And that's not a good thing.
I don't think Trump is capable of handling foreign affairs. He's panicked this week. He's got Mnuchin changing the tax reform to be ready now, not in August. He changed his tune. He's trying to push through. They approved the Iran, say the Iran was following the treaty, but now he wants to review it immediately. And now he's trying to pass a health bill. Trump is panicking in the last of his 100
Well,
days.
Also, Trump has been reversing himself on almost everything that he said during the election. I mean, China's now a nice place to do business with. And,
Rapiness. Yeah,
all of a sudden NATO are a great bunch of guys, you know?
Yeah.
I think he's weighing the benefit of having China.
Phil, bullshit. I'm calling the bullshit alarm on you. He's not doing anything of the sort.
He can fight that battle another day. But right now, the North Korea.
This wasn't just not fighting the battle another day. Saying how good NATO was being and how he liked what NATO was doing now. I mean, all of a sudden, just a few months after he assailed it, you know, the first thing I'm going to do is get us out of NATO. You know, come on. That's a change of course.
I elected him, and we, you know, the country.
No, you elected him. The country didn't elect him, the electors elected him.
That's
fine, and I can hardly wait for you to say that when this happens to a Republican. Okay, the fact is that he's not my president. He's not this country's president. He did not get elected to the post. The electors put him in. Am I right, Jeff? Tell
that's
me I'm wrong.
The way it works.
Hold on. Tell me I'm wrong, Jeff.
I disagree with you on that. That's the way we select the president. And
no, but we were
it's not by the base of public quantities.
Yeah.
It's got to do with states.
The basic exam to get the presidency. The guy is not, he might be a nice guy. He is not capable intelligently or from his experience. He doesn't meet the minimum experience to get the job.
That's all water under the bridge in the Potomac.
One of the countries ask, who do we contact? You don't have a secretary for our part of the world. We have nobody to contact in the State Department.
Trump answers his own phone.
Good. I'll give him a call tomorrow and tell him to go fuck himself. Brian?
Yes. I've been using the Skype messenger more liberally. Mm-hmm. So what I wrote down as far as this
did you put it on my thing here?
There it is.
Look at all that stuff he wrote there.
Yeah, I am also frightened of the notion of someone ascending to the presidency only by popular vote alone. What if instead of using congressional districts, the new version 2.0 electoral college system would tally votes based on counties rather than, you know, because we have over 1,000 counties. I mean, you would have to change the schematics and the math, but I mean, there has to be a buffer between the will of the majority and a filter.
Yeah.
So you mean to say two states are going to control it for all 50? Yeah, no. You know what you want is you want the most populous states.
Let's wait another almost 4 years before we have this discussion again. You know,
well,
it doesn't matter at this point. It's a moot point.
Okay.
All I'm saying is, please don't say that we elected him because the electors gave him the vote. My vote wasn't counted. My vote was distilled. My vote was
the electors gave him the vote via congressional districts that were gerrymandered the shit out of over the last how many years?
Yeah, and also remember always,
he won the popular vote though.
They won the popular vote. Remember,
he was a popular guy.
Oh Jesus, I can't say anything, Phil.
Fuck. I'm waiting on that. Crack in your ass, Phil. I can put quarters in so you can spout more right-wing talking points on command, just like, you know, a piggy bank.
What? That he wasn't a popular guy?
No, the fact that you, Donald Trump could publicly say that he worships.
Phil, he got waxed by 3 million votes. By 3 million votes. It's a lot of votes, Phil.
In two states. They were two states.
I don't care. This should be a country where when I go in to a polling booth and I give my vote, okay, my vote counts. And it doesn't. Well, and it doesn't. It doesn't here because I know that Hillary was going to take New York and she was going to get those electors. But what about the Republican here who did vote for Trump? He doesn't get counted.
For Trump in California, and I didn't.
Well, then you should be pissed as hell.
No,
well, Kevin, chime in. He hasn't said much tonight.
No, I was just agreeing. California gets a shit end of the stick anyway.
Oh, it always gets.
You know what's going on. By the time everything's going on, we know what's happening.
Oh, I remember. I was working. I was working at KMEL in San Francisco, and we were going to do election night coverage when Reagan was reelected. And as I'm driving over the bridge, I'm listening to the news, and of course, the news is coming out of New York, and they say, "And we're now calling the election for Ronald Reagan." And we hadn't even closed the polls in California, right? And I almost just turned around and went right home. Can I can I finish one sentence, just one sentence, without you chiming in?
You can one.
One. Okay. Good. One. Well, I had my one. Go ahead. One.
All right. Time's
what was,
up.
What was so important that you had to spout something? Go ahead.
Oh, that after that happened, it was agreed that the news they would never call the election until all the states. We're in.
You fine. We still get robbed. You know, we still get robbed in California.
Right, but it doesn't stop people from going to the polls.
Let me put it this way: no election in my recent memory has ever come down to California. You know.
Yeah.
So. Yes, Kevin.
Although, if you pull California out, you wouldn't have the extra votes you guys claim for Hillary.
Yes, Kevin. Did you raise your hand?
No, I was just throwing up my arm of green.
Oh, you were throwing up your arm of green. Yeah.
Hey, Phil, Alex, is a
tip. No, but wait a minute. Jeff has his hand up.
Yeah. I had a question. Did Reagan have any advantage of being a Californian?
He took California.
First term?
Did he take California in those elections?
Yeah, he took California. I'm sure he did.
Yeah.
But I don't know if that was at the... at the last hour, or that can't remember.
I'll tell you it became a bone of contention for people in California was that people in California always used to get very pissed about the fact in Northern California that Southern California was kind of traditionally conservative and Northern California was traditionally liberal. And there've been constant movements. I don't know if there's one now to take California and split it up into two different states because we have two different sets of needs.
Now
there's always talking about
in Southern California, you got Orange County and San Diego County and the rest of it is all going liberal.
Yeah. So, I think the problem with cutting up California the way they thought it was going to work was wrong because they screwed everybody out of water. If you look at the East Coast, each state is horizontal. Every state has beach access, i.e. that means they have access to water. California, if you were going to cut it up, you would start with Washington, Oregon, Jefferson, which by the way is what North California wants to be called, then the middle of California, or then the Bay Area across, and then the middle, and then you go down to LA, and then you go to San Diego. It would have been a much smarter move, but they didn't float that. What they floated was like five different groups, and they were all cut up, and the poor people were getting shitty all by themselves, and they wouldn't have any of our tax base to help those people. And the same with the mountain people of Northern California to Oregon. They don't have shit for tax base either, and they would have gotten screwed as well. That's why that thing went flames.
All over water. You know, Alex, you showed me a movie once, Chinatown. You said it was one of your favorite movies.
Yeah.
And it was over, you know, water between Northern California and Southern California, mm-hmm. and who was going to control it? If you separated
it was more about somebody controlling the water in Southern California.
Yeah. But what happens is because the water comes from Northern California, feeds the Central Valley for the farming, and then goes to Southern California. If you split the states up, then you would have water issues that I don't think.
Yeah, wouldn't that be terrific?
Dry
those LA motherfuckers up.
And just to make sure, that water's not California water. So
Sierra,
Colorado.
It sound like it's from Colorado. So don't be making it sound like we're doing something.
Southern California relies a lot on the water coming through. Isn't that cute? Isn't that adorable?
There you go.
Hey, Alex, your show has accomplished something tonight.
Yeah, what's it accomplished?
Berkeley is reversed. They're going to have Coulter come and speak on a different day
with about 5 days later.
They must have.
I just posted it on the Facebook comments.
They must
do it on Sunday morning. Do it on a Sunday morning.
Sunday morning.
Why are the anarchists asleep on Sundays?
No, all of you people.
You got a choice: choose between voting or going to see Ann Coulter.
Yeah.
That's
or going to church or going to see Ann Coulter. That's what it is.
I shoot Sunday mornings.
In other news, China has put their bombers on high alert, and Russia is moving their troops toward the borders.
Okay. Of what?
I haven't read it yet.
Wait a minute. Near the borders of what?
Russia.
Between Korea and Russia, I would guess.
No. This will be the European thing. Russia's been getting... Before Trump was elected, Russia has been getting really pissy in Eastern Europe. And there's two countries, and one in particular, that have been having to beef up all of their border defenses, more military. And just after Trump was elected, I think, I'm not 100% sure because I was out of it, that he gave permission to send even more of our military to go up against Putin's military in some Eastern European country, and I could look it up. But
yeah, I think it's the Czech Republic.
They're moving troops to the North Korean border, too, according to CNN. I'll post that on the Facebook.
Chinese troops or Russian troops?
No, Russian troops.
I don't think North Korea wants the Russian troops in their country. I don't see that happening. I think
they're just protecting their border.
The border with North Korea.
Well, this is going to get.
Yeah, but see, this is a normal saber rattling for Kim Jong-un. I don't know why we discuss it each time.
It's like Will Durst said. You know, Kim Jong Un is just pissed off now because he's not the worst leader in the world.
Yeah, I was thinking that. Write a letter to Kim Jong Un saying, "Hey, guess what? This is your opportunity to go up in the world leader standings."
Yeah.
Just a jackass.
Well, you know,
a show of hands of who's seen the movie Idiocracy?
I haven't seen it yet.
Right here.
Great. Where we elect a professional wrestler as president?
Well, you have to explain the entire picture, and that is that because of the weaning down of intelligence in America, everybody is stupid. And this guy goes into a state of, what do we call it, hibernation, and when he wakes up, he's the smartest man in the world, because everybody's been watching, you know, dumbed down television, dumbed down newscasts, and everything else. Now everybody's just dumbed down. And
because I used to belong to zero population growth, but if you think about it, all the smart people would eventually disappear.
Well, you know, if you went into some kind of cryogenic suspension, say in 1900, and you woke up now, this world would look insane to you. Absolutely insane. And all I've said, the only thing I've ever said about other countries was I have found that where other countries are concerned, if you want to find out what a country is like, all you have to do and understand them is to watch their television. And you watch our television, and we're an idiocracy. We really are. Jerry Springer.
That's the Trump show 24 hours a day on cable now.
The
whole election was a Trump show.
Yeah. Yeah, so, you know.
And he is good. He's good at one thing. He's good at putting grade B-minus shows on TV, grade C shows.
And also starring in one of them as well, so, you know.
Right, he's a bigger-than-life character.
Yeah.
That scares the hell out of me.
Yeah. Anyway, I think we got a little theme. There we go. There's our little theme song. Hey, listen, this has been a good one tonight. We've been all over the place. Phil, thank you as usual. Kevin, thank you. Who was kissing you, by the way?
That was my daughter.
That was your daughter. She's adorable.
Thank you.
Renee, thank you so much. You know, the show is so much better now that you're back with us again.
How many computers did you throw?
I believe it.
Yeah, you know. Well, is she saving money on computers? Because now she doesn't have to throw computers at the wall. She can just get on the air and yell at you, right. Phil.
Yeah, we're going to talk about what Phil did to me today.
Okay, and Brian. Brian, thank you. I love your pithiness. Rob, it's so relaxing to see you there, kind of just to kind of Did you doze off at all during this?
No,
you didn't. But I just wonder if, you know, if so comfy that I fall, I start falling asleep looking at you. Yeah, Jeff, always a pleasure having you here. It's only the Three Beard Club tonight. And Tim, of course, thank you as always. And we hope we'll see you all again back here tomorrow night. Thanks, everybody. Wave goodbye. Okay, that's it, folks. That's all she wrote. Let me close down the Skype here. Okay, I close Skype. You know what I have to do, though, when we do this other thing? I have to actually just kill Skype. Sign out. There we go. Oops. Okay, there we go. I signed out. All right. Anyway, where are we? I got a whole bunch of things going wacko here on me. I am trying to get rid of all. Well, I'll take care of it in a moment as soon as I get rid of this show. Thank you so much, everybody, for having joined us this evening. We'll see you again tomorrow. Same time, same station in life. In the meantime, as always, if you see her, tell her I love her, okay?